coffin, a clean white mug and a smile when the waitress hears that I was born in North Carolina, not an hour from her hometown. And we used to play the same pizza bar, the pinball. And there's a glance in time suspended as I wonder how it is. We've been swept up just by circumstance to where the coyote lives. But my days are strips of highway, and she's wiping tables down, holding on, and still waiting for that windfall. But I've come home, even though I've never had so far to go.
Ah! Welcome. My name is Beverly Smurha, and I'm a member of the Board of Trustees. Welcome to the First Unitarian Church of Oakland. At First Unitarian, we are working to becoming an intentionally multi-generational, multi-racial, multi-cultural, inclusive, and anti-oppressive religious community. You are welcome here. We invite newcomers to fill out our online guest connection card. Go to the website, select the Connect drop-down menu, and you will find a link to the card under Connecting. You can also sign up for our Chalice Chatter newsletter here. We're glad you're here with us this morning. We start our services with these words. We acknowledge the land and the peoples who belong to this land, the Mwikma'a Ohlone peoples, our church, institutions, and homes are occupying their lands. We acknowledge that the lands were stolen from the Ohlone peoples, who have an ancestral relationship with this land, the plants, the animals, and the water, for millennia continuous to the present day. Ohlone people are still here. In solidarity with all indigenous people and their right to self-determination and justice, we commit to working towards accountability for the theft and toward being active partners in the healing of the intergenerational trauma which persists until this day.
Thank you, Bev. And thank you for serving on the board. We light our peace candle for the people of Afghanistan, Sudan, Yemen, Ukraine, and so many other places in this world where lives are disrupted by warfare and violence. All people deserve to live in peace. We light our Black Lives Matter candle in the belief that only when Black and Brown people are valued as the beautiful whole beings they are, can we have a just and equitable society and become the beloved community we aspire to be. And together we say, Black Lives Matter. And now we'll light our chalice with our chalice words. Will you follow along with the hand motions if you know them, or just say the words? We light this chalice, symbol of Unitarian Universalism. May it remind us of the divine spark in all of creation, the power of love to heal what is broken, and to be grateful for life's blessings each day. Thank you.
Friends, let us take a moment now to just feel where we are. Feel yourself in your chair. Feel your feet on the floor. Feel your hands. Wherever they are, maybe they're in your lap, maybe they're moving restlessly, maybe you like to keep them on the arms of your chair. Let us feel ourselves to be in this space. And once you notice where your body is in space and time, notice your breath. There's no need to breathe deeply or any sort of mindfulness exercise here. Just notice your breathing. Notice the air traveling in and out of your body, and then expand that noticing to include the rest of the room. And notice that everyone else in here is breathing as well. That everyone else is here, just as you are here. We are all here together, whether you're on Zoom, whether you're physically in this room, here we are, together, at last. Will the people say with me, come, let us worship together.
And, O Spirit, to sing our first hymn, 'Tis a Gift to Be Simple.
So, I'm wondering if anybody in this room has learned anything recently that they would like to share with other people. Could be something small, like maybe you baked an amazing pie crust and you want to share that tip with others. Or maybe it's something big, like some sort of piece of, you know, really massive life wisdom about life, love, loss, grief, joy, celebration, any of those things. All right, we have a hand over here. I'm going to ask you to help me pass this microphone down.
I just learned that the use of the word they as gender neutral dates back to the Middle Ages.
Yes, I just learned that Huey Newton, famed figure in Oakland history, after his release from the county courthouse, moved into the penthouse of the skyscraper building, more or less catter-corner from the courthouse. And there is a Huey Newton Foundation over on Broadway, 16.
I noticed that sign myself while I was walking by. So we've learned some things about grammar, and we've learned some things about Oakland history. Has anyone else learned anything recently? Oh, I see some in the back. I'm coming to you. Well, I wore my running shoes.
Last night, I saw a film made by two San Francisco UU congregants about the, I guess, now 27 UU congregations in the Philippines. Yes.
27 UU congregations in the Philippines. Okay, there's a...
Well, I'm learning not very good at... I'm mentoring and supporting my teaching assistants in summer school.
Sometimes we learn something hard about ourselves. That is true, and that's also valuable learning to learn when you have a growing edge. Oh, is there a hand back here?
I learned that even Unitarians can go see the Barbie movie and you should wear hot pink.
That's right. You're learning anyone can go see the Barbie movie. Was there? Oh.
I'm learning the hard lesson that the emotional reaction I have with my partner is all about me learning to be okay with myself and not put my stuff on him. And I'm reading a book called Love and Rage, and it's really helping me to realize that I can use my anger if I embrace it and not push it away, but use it for energy. And it's a relief, and it's kind of scary. Because I can't keep blaming him. That's scary.
Oh, that big sigh. I really felt that big sigh. That is a big learning, to learn like when something is mine and when something is yours. I mean, that's something we spend our whole lives learning about, I think.
You probably already knew this, but I learned that the United States has more than 400 military installations all over the world. More than 400.
Woof, that's a big number and a big learning. All right, I see you over there. I'm coming.
I learned that I and our culture is biased about our thinking patterns, that typical neurology is the good one and atypical is something wrong with it, and that it's a bias, like a lot of other biases.
And at our neighborhood coffee gathering yesterday, I learned that the mother of a little six-month-old is back to work, but the dad is still on maternity leave. So social justice does have some positive consequences.
Yes, it's hard to learn that the world is not what we thought it was, but it's also good to learn that progress is being made.
I've been a Unitarian since 1980 in four different churches, and yesterday was the first time I went to an ordination, and it was really a beautiful, beautiful thing to witness and be part of, and I thank everybody here and you for what happened.
Oh, thank you. It's never too late to try something new, do something you've never done before. All right, and so now we've heard from quite a few people. I mean, I could do this for the entire service, but maybe there's other things that you want to do, like sing more. But we've heard from a lot of different people who've learned a lot of things recently, some of which were personal, some of which were sort of more external. And I think one of the remarkable things about being part of a community like this one is that we can share those learnings with each other, with people that, you know, we might not see every day, people that we might not encounter otherwise, if not for church. And that is a beautiful thing, that we as a community can always be learning and growing together, learning things about ourselves, learning things about the world, and vice versa, and just helping each other along in this spiritual journey that we call life. Thank you for joining me for this Time for All Ages. Love all the participation. And now, I think, are we singing people out now?
Hi, everybody. I'm Emily Stoper. This is the time in the service when we have a few minutes to walk around and greet one another. I never have enough time to talk to all the people I want to talk to. Of course, I want to greet old friends, and I'm always curious to talk to newcomers, but it also seems important to talk a little with anyone that no one else is talking to, because I've been that person too. So come on, let's get out there and greet, greet, greet.
Yes, there you go.
Hi, Micah. Beloveds, your energy, your love and generosity is a wonderful thing. Thank you for bringing all of you today, and thank you for seeing all in everyone else. I invite you now that you've sat down and gotten comfortable, won't you please rise and join us again in singing? Thank you.
Words are from Rachel Rott of Palomar Unitarian Universalist Fellowship in Vista, California. Today, I will consider what it is like for you. With a spirit of curiosity, I will hold gently the moments that you give to me, the stories, the longings, the regrets, the fears. For your trust in me, I will be grateful. I won't be afraid to live with a heart broken wide open by the tenderness of the moment when a thread connects your heart to mine. We now take time in our service to speak and to hear the names of those we grieve for or celebrate, to share with each other, to connect our hearts in embracing meditation. For the names spoken aloud and those carried silently in our hearts, we say, we hold them in our care.
Friends, will you please join me in the spirit of prayer? To that great mystery which pervades the universe, the ties that bind us, the connections that run between us, that great mystery. We have so many questions, always. Why do bad things happen to good people? Why do good things happen to bad people? Why do we suffer? What can we do about that suffering? To that great mystery, we commend our wonderings. And we know also that joy and sorrow are often finely woven, that yesterday there was an ordination, and yesterday there was also a memorial. That every day there is a funeral, and every day there is a birthday. Every day there is something to celebrate, every day there is something to grieve. And this too, this complicated mess, this wondering that is part of life, we also turn to that great mystery and wonder why. Why is life this way? And perhaps today we do not hear an answer. And so we turn to one another for answers, and often none of us have answers either. These things are beyond our knowing. And at last, all that we can do is grieve with one another and celebrate with one another. To remember that though we may be unique, the things that happen to us are not. That this too, joy or sorrow, shall pass, and that none of it needs to be borne alone, that we always, always, always hold one another in our care. Amen, and blessed be.
Thank you.
Okay. Good morning, Oakland. That was pretty good. That was pretty good. All right. It's good to be back. It's good to look at that. Oh, thank you. It's good to look at that big stained glass in the back there. I don't know how many of y'all have ever really looked at that stained glass. I'm not sure you can see it from down there, actually, because it was really designed to be seen from the pulpit. It's a stained glass of St. John the Revelator with the words, "And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful." I actually have those words tattooed on my arm here. It's a way that I keep Oakland part of me, and also a reminder of the call that I heard here, because that stained glass and those words were placed there to remind the preacher to always speak the truth. And so I hope that my words today are truthful for you. So I left in 2018. For those of you who don't know me, this is my home church. This is the church that I came up in. I first started coming to this church in 2009 or 2010. I'm not entirely certain. And with each passing year, you know, it gets farther and farther away. Turns out time works like that. So in the last 5 years, I've been seeing and doing a lot. I first moved to Cleveland, where I did my ministerial internship at a large suburban church in a suburb of Cleveland. That was a 500-member church, fully staffed. And then I spent a couple of years working in a very different environment, the Cleveland VA, as first a chaplain resident and then a chaplain fellow, where I specialized in mental health. And then after that, I moved to North Carolina, and now I live in the smallest town that I've ever lived in. The whole county only has fewer than 70,000 people. And it's on the coast of North Carolina, so it's this sort of semi-rural sort of location where I'm the interim minister at a very, very tiny congregation, 75 members. But oh my goodness, so much heart. You know, this is a very sweet and engaged congregation, and they're really this very tiny, progressive oasis in what is otherwise an extremely, extremely conservative county. There's a Confederate statue and everything, and, you know, wouldn't you know it, they placed that Confederate statue right in front of a black church. So they would, you know, so they would have to see that when they walk out. Oh, yeah, and there was a pandemic also somewhere in there. Maybe you heard about that. So I took up hobbies during the pandemic. Maybe some of you also took up a new hobby, like baking sourdough bread or bird watching. I did get a bird feeder, learned a lot about blue jays and purple finches. I started painting. I made Salisbury steak from scratch. And I watched a lot of old movies. You know, movies sort of like, oh, I've been meaning to watch that for a while and just, you never get around to it, actually. And one of those movies that I ended up watching was the movie Harvey from 1950. Has anyone watched Harvey? Oh, quite a few people have watched Harvey. Yeah, it has Jimmy Stewart in it. Mm-hmm. So, for those of you who have not watched Harvey, Jimmy Stewart plays Elwood P. Dowd, who's this wealthy white man with this particular eccentricity, which is that he has essentially an invisible friend named Harvey. And Harvey is a 6-foot-tall white rabbit, so he's taller than Jimmy Stewart. He talks to Harvey like this, you know, a lot of the time. And he holds the door for Harvey. He carries Harvey's hat and coat for him. You know it's Harvey's hat because it has two holes cut in it for his ears. He has conversations with Harvey that other people only hear one side of, and Harvey's sister, Vita, finds this incredibly embarrassing. Like, Elwood is just, oh my goodness, he is so embarrassing to her, and she is at her wit's end about Elwood and eventually conspires to have him committed to a sanatorium, which is what they called, you know, mental health hospitals back in the day. And then this comedy of errors kind of ensues when she tries to have him committed to the sanatorium, and you know, there's people chasing each other around town. That's less important. Over the course of this movie, however, we get to know Elwood quite a bit, and we see how Elwood treats everyone he meets like a friend he just hasn't gotten to know yet. He invites perfect strangers to his house for dinner, like when he meets the security guard at the sanatorium, who's invented this sort of mechanical gate. He goes, wow, that is just amazing. Say, would you like to come to my house for dinner? When? What about tomorrow night? Can you come tomorrow night? And he makes sure, you know, he has his phone number and everything. And he treats everyone with that same courtesy and respect and intense interest in who they are, whether it's the doctor at the sanatorium or his sister's wealthy friends or a barfly with a criminal record, all of them totally the same to Elwood. So at one point in the movie, Dr. Chumley, who's one of the doctors at the sanatorium, who's gotten to know Harvey as well, he asks Elwood, you know, why aren't you more upset that your sister is trying to have you committed? You know, she's got this whole conspiracy against you. And Elwood responds, and Elwood is not upset about this. You kind of never really see Elwood very upset or angry or anything during the course of this movie. And he says to the doctor, you know, doctor, my mother used to tell me Elwood. My mother always called me Elwood. Elwood, in this world, you must be oh so smart or oh so pleasant. I used to be smart. I recommend pleasant. And you know, that really stuck with me. And over time, I think I have come to agree, largely, not all the time, but a lot of the time, with Elwood's mother. Because now I have seen and been in many situations in which it doesn't really matter, you know, who's smart or who's right. When a patient is undergoing a risky surgery in the morning, and he calls for the chaplain late at night, and he asks the chaplain, chaplain, is it true that in order to get to heaven, all I have to do is accept Jesus into my heart? It doesn't matter what the technically right answer is to that question, which is going to be different depending on who you ask, right? What matters is, why is he asking that question? Is he afraid? Is he maybe ashamed of things that he's done in his life, and he's worried that even if he has accepted Jesus into his heart, that Jesus is going to meet him at the pearly gates and say, oh no, not you, not you, away with you. You know, when a little church in a deep red county, that where 70, 80% of the voting population voted for Trump, where there's Confederate statues and Confederate flags, when a little church in a county like that is wondering whether or not we should put up a pride flag outside of the church, it matters maybe less what is the right thing to do in that situation. Because, yeah, safety is a real concern. And also letting people know what we stand for is also a real concern. So who's right? You know, depends on who you ask, right? And so what matters in that situation is that this decision is being made together, and that we're talking about this decision together and really listening to each other and being honest with one another and being open with one another. That's what matters. There's a saying, you know, there's an African proverb, and it hurts me that I can't find anything more specific than that. You know, I tried to research where is this saying really from, and all I could find was African proverb, and I was like, Africa's a continent? You know, so I wish I could be more specific about this, that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, you go together. So I do want to acknowledge that while I'm still talking about the movie Harvey, which, yes, I'm talking about Harvey again, that Elwood has it easy in a lot of respects. I think the movie might be different if the main character were, say, a poorer black man who saw a giant talking rabbit, right? Elwood gets to prioritize being pleasant because he's independently wealthy. As far as we can tell, he doesn't work. Able-bodied, white, male, and of course there are systemic issues that do deserve our righteous indignation. I'm not talking about tone policing here, and I know that some of y'all know what tone policing means. Pleasantness, maybe, is not going to get us super far in our fight for climate justice, reproductive justice, LGBTQ plus rights. And I also want to point out that I think, you know, what I've learned is that I think being smart or being righteous will only get us so far in our quest for beloved community. Because that is ultimately our goal, right? Beloved community, right? Good. World community with peace, liberty, and justice for all, right? That world where racism and poverty doesn't exist because people of conscience have just decided, nuh-uh, we're not going to stand for this anymore. That world, you know, beloved community will have conflict, does have conflict, but it's conflict that will be resolved without violence because we will have made the conscious decision to be a people of peace. So to that end, we do need to learn to be pleasant. We need to learn to be pleasant. We need to learn to listen to each other the same way that Elwood listens to nurses and barflies and doctors with the same genuine interest in each and every one of them. We need to treat every person with the same courtesy and respect, even if they're someone who is trying to have us committed to a sanatorium. We need to invite strangers over for dinner and not just say, we should get together for dinner sometime. Yeah, sometime. Great, I'll call you. And then never call them. Right? But to really make concrete plans. Say, when? What about tomorrow night? I'm having some friends over. Just an informal thing. And, you know, it didn't escape me, watching this movie, thinking about this movie afterward, that in this movie about so many smart people, you know, doctors and high society people, and that Elwood is the only person in this movie who was genuinely happy with his life. When asked, you know, where he would time travel to, if he could time travel, he said, well, I've never wanted to be anywhere but here, but where I am right now, doing what I'm doing right now. Man, how many of us can say that about our lives? You know, in my own thinking, I know that a lot of y'all, you know, kind of still see me as, you know, a 20-something-year-old who first started coming to church in 2009 or 2010 or whenever it was. But I hate to tell you that I'm middle-aged now, actually. Like, I'm almost 40. I have back pain. You know, I'm not going to be able to run around with a microphone like I did just now forever. Those of you who aren't 40 yet, yeah, it's true. What they say is true. But I'm middle-aged now, and so as I'm middle-aged, approaching middle-age, I find myself looking back a lot more, and also approaching the way that I see the future differently, that I think often about being a good ancestor. That was what I told y'all yesterday at the benediction. Because there reaches a point when what you're doing today isn't just for you. It reaches a point where what you're doing today, you're doing for those who come after you. Those whose faces you're never going to see, you're never going to know. Those whose lives will be radically different from yours. But that's who you're acting for today. Because when you look at things in the long term, in the extremely long term, someday all of this is going to end. The sun will die in the process, it'll destroy Earth and the rest of the solar system, the universe itself will die when it runs out of energy to continue expanding. I don't really understand heat death, I'm not a physicist. And at the end of all things, it won't matter who was right about whatever argument you were having this weekend, about the right way to load the dishwasher, or, you know, who to vote for in the next election, or, you know, whether this belt matches these shoes. At the end of all things, it will not matter which God you believed in, or whether that hat looked stupid on you. At the end of all things, we do become one. And then it doesn't matter, at the end of all things, who was right, because it turns out we were all one after all. And if the universe is too big to think about, if thinking about the end of the universe is just too cripplingly depressing, don't think about it. You don't have to think about it. What you can think about is what will matter and what won't matter when you're on your deathbed. Because I've seen, you know, a not insignificant amount of this too, and I'll tell you that I've yet to see anybody lie on their deathbed wishing they had spent more time at the office. At the end of all things, people think about their loved ones, their families, how they wish they had more time, how they wish they had a better relationship with their son, how they wish they'd been kinder to their sister, how they wish they'd taken more vacation days and they were kinder to themselves. What matters when you're on your deathbed is who is there to hold your hand. It doesn't matter whether you were right. It doesn't matter whether you were wrong. It matters who's holding your hand then. What matters is, after you're gone, how they talk about you afterward. Whether or not they pass down your words of wisdom. Whether or not they pass down your love. Because love is infinite. I am quite certain that love will outlast the universe. And love matters more than being right. Love is what will build beloved community. And at the end of all things, love is the only thing that will matter. So be a good ancestor. Pass down good wisdom. Whatever it is that you do today, do it for people 100 or 150 years from now. Pass down a legacy of kindness so that maybe someday somebody will say what Elwood said about his mother. Say, you know, this advice that my mother had for me. In this life, you must be oh so smart or oh so pleasant. I used to be smart, but I recommend pleasant. May it be so.
Hello. So we are calling what I'm doing now, weaving the tapestry of community, because we are joining our offering with our announcements. This is something that we're doing to build community. And often when we do the offering, the person who stands up and talks gives an example of why they come, why they love this community. And I think for any of us who were here yesterday, it was such a joyous experience to be part of reordaining Reverend Micah C. Ma. That's one of the reasons I'm a Unitarian, because I want to be part of a denomination where the congregation does the ordaining. It was such a special and lovely thing, and I'm blessed to be part of that. Will the ushers please come forward? And while we are passing the baskets, I have a few announcements to bring us closer as community. The first is to encourage folks to participate in our summer read. Our book is called Mistakes and Miracles: Congregations on the Road to Multiculturalism. We said that as our as part of our vision. It's something that many of us in the congregation are reading, and hopefully as many as possible are getting together to talk about it. We've had one meeting to talk about it, and there will be more. So look for those times in your chalice chatter. And in the meantime, happy reading. Second announcement is that we have our monthly potluck today after service. And it does not matter if you brought food, there will be food for you. So please come and join us in Venti Hall. And thirdly, if you are new or newish to this congregation, I encourage you to meet with Emily Stoper. After service, she'll be standing here and will tell you a few things and answer your questions about us. And now we're going to say our congregational commitment. I think our ushers are already counting the money. So maybe we'll all just say this together. To the work of the church, which is weaving a tapestry of love we call community, we dedicate ourselves and those our offerings. Thank you.
I now invite you to rise once again in body and or spirit to sing our final hymn, Wo Ya Ya.
On. Okay. Because it's benediction time now, right? Yeah. So that means, why is everyone sitting down again? Did we stop holding hands at some point? This is the problem with being gone for 5 years, you know, is that people, places, and things don't stay where you left them, it turns out. But I invite everyone to hold hands now if you're comfortable. If you're not comfortable, please just make that clear. And you can, you know, just touch spirits or something. All right, I'm here too. All right, yes, and we always make some kind of amorphous blob, which I think is a really great symbol of community, actually. So my benediction is really just to repeat the words that I said at my ordination or reordination yesterday, which is to be a good ancestor. In all that you do, be a good ancestor. May our legacies of kindness and compassion live on and on and on until the end of all things. Amen and blessed be.